So thank you very much for joining us to talk about observing systems and the importance of good information to help guide decisions. I am only disappointed by the fact that this room is not standing room only. And the reason I say that is because in so many of the other sessions, there has been an emphasis placed on how important it is that we invest in science, in research, in observing, and in making certain that that information gets networked in a way that is really useful to decision makers. So I guess I will just say that we are going to have a wonderful week, a wonderful hour, and hopefully after today, you will be able to share some of what we talk about during this session with others to help spread information. So my name is Fran Ulmer, and I will be your moderator. I am chair of the U.S. Arctic Research Commission, and I am thrilled to be a part of this panel because I think that this is an incredibly important topic. And to do a kickoff speech for us, I'm really pleased to have the opportunity to introduce Kathy Sullivan. Kathy Sullivan is the administrator of NOAA. She is a respected oceanographer, and she is formerly an astronaut and the first woman to walk in space from the United States, which I think is just fabulous. So without any further ado, Kathy Sullivan, please come share with us some of your thoughts about the importance of environmental intelligence.
Well, thank you, Fran, and let me just say I share Fran's sense both of other sessions and of, a little bit the dearth of people in this room, certainly not standing room only, and with all due respect to a number of very good friends and colleagues I see here, there are just a few too many members of the choir here to again sing our same songs together. And the song we're singing, of course, boils down to we need more assets and resources to be able to provide the kind of information that decision makers all around us are expecting. I have the same perception that Fran opened with over the course of the day. I've listened to individuals from all walks of life, business, finance, fisheries, foreign ministries, from all around the globe, talk about the importance of the Arctic region, the need to focus more attention to understand the changes that are happening here, to have the kind of information we need to manage fisheries, to make a community sustainable, to sustain public health, to grow viable businesses. We've heard all of that all day long and all the implications that come with it. For those of us from outside, as we say in the United States, anyone who's not from Alaska is outside. There's Alaska and there's just the world outside. I'm an outsider. And so these opportunities for me are glimpses, very powerful glimpses of the kinds of change and the sorts of issues that these changes bring to the fore. For many people in this room, some folks here on the panel, this is, of course, these are not glimpses. These are recitations. These are reminders. These are demonstrations, again, of the consequences that Arctic peoples are living with every single day. And from the opening plenary through every single session, we've heard the litany, thinning sea ice, shrinking glaciers, shifting seasonal patterns, melting permafrost, rising river discharges, all of those things combined. We've heard repeatedly that what happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic, and that what's happening at lower latitudes is also coming to the Arctic. And all of these things we've heard over and over again, as different as they are, they have this one thing in common. They dramatize the need for us to accelerate the production of actionable, science-based information, what we call at NOAA environmental intelligence, that's needed to support the activities and help answer the questions and solve the challenges that these changes raise. The last three or four speakers at the session in this room immediately before ours on fisheries emphasized over and over again, we have to have baseline information. We have to have the science to paint the starting picture so that as the Central Arctic Ocean opens and as prospects of fish stocks moving into that region expands, we're ready with information. We're ready with insight. We're ready with the ability to manage a changing fishery and a changing ocean more sustainably than we've done in some past instances. And that's why this session is actually so important. And in a sense, it rightly comes at the end of the program, because it is only through improved observations sustained and systematic observations that we can generate the kinds of insights and that actionable intelligence that we really need. So let me poke a little more for you at what we mean at NOAA when we use that term environmental intelligence. We don't mean just the buckets of data that are collected by instruments and poured into computers. And we don't mean just the research papers that fill volumes on library shelves. We mean things like this. We mean the information that's arriving at the on the bridge or in the hand of a cargo ship and the marine pilot who's navigating through Arctic waters that gives that individual accurate near real-time wind, wave, and water conditions. All of that is underpinned by in situ observations that let that navigator know with greater confidence where they can take their vessel, what the condition of the tide is going to do to them, whether they can make it through a channel or not. For Alaska's Governor Walker, it's everyday weather and forecasts and warnings, again, fed by ocean observations, by buoys, by airborne and satellite sensors that he turns to when dealing with wildfires, with coastal evacuations, or just checking to make sure that the cargo hub, called Anchorage International Airport, can still serve its role as a global lifeline between the United States, North America, and Asian regions. And for emergency managers in all Arctic regions and natural resource managers, it's tools like the Environmental Response Management Application, a public-facing web-based tool that lets all sorts of layers of information come together and be fused so that all of those people I mentioned, plus researchers, plus citizens in the field, can see the picture, the activity levels of ships, of fissures, of storms, of oil discharges, whatever that might be. These are what we call decision support tools. They're designed to bring observations off the pages of journals, out of the scientific data buckets, and into the hands and into the decision space of real people living in the real towns and villages of the Arctic, running the real businesses, making lives and livelihoods in this really dramatic, dynamic region. None of that actionable information, none of that decision support is possible without good observations. In the Arctic, there are a number of notable gaps, which I'm sure my colleagues on the panel will touch on and amplify. I would highlight a few that I've really been struck by just in my few days here in state so far. Ocean current and subsurface temperature information all across Arctic waters are really incredibly sparse, far too sparse to support the kind of sea ice forecasting that increasing and changing economic and commercial activities in Arctic waters are going to challenge us to have. Coastal and river water level informations, measurements, ongoing consistent measurements that can feed into computing tools that give us forecasts. The real goal of environmental intelligence, the sweet spot of environmental intelligence, is practical prediction. It's the ability to give to decision makers, to villagers, to business people, to governors, a picture of what's coming ahead, a reliable picture of what's coming ahead, so they can plan ahead, they can think ahead, they can evaluate alternative courses of actions, and hopefully choose a wiser course of action that does a better job of protecting lives and sustaining livelihoods. The wind speed and wind direction profiles for the atmosphere that could drastically sharpen our predictions of atmospheric turbulence, aircraft icing, and tell us where volcanic ash may be transported around the North Pacific region. Those are just a few examples. As we go and talk together about how to work together to fill these kinds of gaps and to try to provide the sort of sustained observing that we all know we need, I would emphasize a couple of things. It's important that whatever actions we put together produce accurate data and that a set of measurements that is sustained for the long time. That's both sustained commitment, not just research campaign by research campaign, and it speaks to the engineering challenges of designing instrumentation and observing systems that can work in the rural, sparse, and harsh regions of the Arctic. It's really vital that we all work together across in the Circumarctic region to make our data interoperable and produced in easy-to-use formats. So conditions move around the Arctic, we all know that. The environmental conditions, Mother Nature doesn't care much about the administrative boundaries we draw between states or regions or countries. It's really important that our data be able to work across all of those boundaries as well. We would urge at NOAA that we focus our efforts on thinking about what sorts of data need to be collected that are oriented towards the real world user needs that I've been referring to. networks that are beyond research campaign networks that really do address the sorts of real-world decision-making needs that are growing in all of our states and regions. And to be sure that our observations are really needs-oriented in this fashion, we believe it's imperative that Arctic residents be engaged from the start, both to properly assess the demands, the greatest, most pressing information needs, and to be sure that their native knowledge, their long-standing understanding of this region is factored in to the plan and the observations as well. So the bottom line, we need more measurements, but we need more consistent, more sustained, more interoperable in-situ measurements of sea ice, the atmosphere, the ocean conditions, and terrestrial conditions as well. None of this will be possible without all of us across the Arctic region coming together, academics, business, military, formal governments, local peoples, native residents, and working together to make the observing system that this dynamic region really clamors for and that all the topics we've talked about today tell us we must begin to respond to. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kathy, and thank you for your service to this country in all the ways in which you have served our country. You have consistently and very clearly explained why investment in science, particularly when directed toward decisions that need to be made by the public and private sector, is an imperative for our nation and for all of the nations of the Arctic. So thank you for your very clear statement today and the work that you are doing. You mentioned that these systems are not clearly delineated by the kinds of boundaries that appear on maps. And so it's very appropriate that our first panelist is going to speak as someone who is a resident of Norway, someone who is an expert in trying to work in this international sphere of bringing scientists and countries together. Kristine Olseng is Special Advisor on Polar Research. She is with the Norwegian Research Council, which is actually where I met her for the first time in Norway in January when I was taking a tour of the council buildings. And she is Chair of the Sustaining Arctic Observing Networks, SAON. I'm just curious, how many people in this room have ever heard of SAON before? Raise your hand. Okay, this is not your audience. The normal audience would not be doing that. That confirms my belief that we have a very select group of people who are already incredibly knowledgeable of how important this work is. But for those of you who didn't raise your hand, Kristine is about to tell you about SAON and about the work that the Norwegian Research Council does. Please help me welcome her.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity to be here. I'm glad to see so many people here and also see so many knows about SAON. That's good. I must just add that I just took over as a chair for SAON 2 weeks ago, so I will try my best if you have some question about details and history, but I hope somebody in my vice chair will help me out if I have some difficulties. So I won't state anything about why we need to have observing systems or why it's important to integrate them, etc. You all know that already. What I tried to do, I got this difficult task to be Pan-Arctic, International, European, Norwegian, and SAON in 5 minutes, 5 to 7 minutes. So it's impossible. So I just will give you some bits and pieces in the big picture. And I will present something about SAON in the end. So I try to just see from a Pan-Arctic view, what do we have? We clearly have a lot of networks, observing systems, and we could put a lot of efforts in putting them together, bringing them together and cooperate with each other. We also see that we have a lot of observing systems that are fragmented and exist in varying stages of development. I will show you some examples afterwards. You also have that many observations are managed by individual sponsors for specific purposes. And we also have a lot of observation on project basis, and many are not available. Despite our long history of Arctic observation, long-term records are incomplete, as Katie just also said, and there are measurement gaps in many domains. If you looked at just of the recent IPCC report, you can see that there are white spots in the Arctic. It's easy to see that we need some more measurements. I will, from the Norwegian side, actually, or European side, I will just use an example of to show some challenges and also some lessons learned in trying to establish the Svalbard Integrated Observing System. How many of you have heard about that? Not that many. Good. So, this is a support action funded by the EU. And it had just been through a four-year preparation phase. The main goal is actually to create a state-of-the-art Earth system observing system to answer questions related to global change. I will use this as an example because I think that some of this lesson learned actually show what we need when we cooperate multinationally and also multidisciplinary. So I'll just take a brief through it. Svalbard is has about 13 nations are present in Svalbard at four major settlements, and there are numbers of monitoring sites and offshore facilities. And it's not, I mean, you can see why you need to combine. There are several countries having their own observation programs and also a better coordination will also avoid duplication and also making joint efforts to fill gaps in the long term. So for 4 years, we have developed strategies. You need to have common strategies if you're going to develop observing systems multinationally. Takes time to get common understanding what to achieve, and you also have a lot of different funding mechanisms between different countries. For this project, funding from EU was crucial. It takes time and also to develop all the documents needed and also to set up an organization. This project is not yet, it's just started its implementation phase, going through the next 3 years, so it takes time. So we hope that in 7 years it's operational. So I just wanted to state that it takes time to develop, to agree. So I hope we can do some efforts to actually do this a little bit faster if you're going to the Pan-Arctic level. Okay. 1 minute left. Yeah, okay. Yeah, just going to slip. Yeah, good. And then we'll say something about SAON. You all heard about it. I've been on the way for since 2007. And the goal is actually to, the goal is to enhance the Arctic-wide observing activities by facilitating partnerships and observing and data networks. It should build on promoting sharing and synthesis of data and information. SAON is also committed to facilitating an inclusion of Arctic Indigenous people in observing activities, in particular promoting community-based monitoring. In SAON, all countries are welcome to participate on an equal basis. SAON has been underway for a long time, and we were used as 5 years to do the initial work, and in 2012, SAON was established formally. We have created two subgroups, committees, one on data, working very well, is merged with the IASC working group, since you all probably know that as well. And they have found some quite distinct products to develop. So, we also have the network group, network observation group, that will also contribute to what you probably also know, the EU PolarNet, is the new instrument for EU to make a common polar program in a 5 year time. So I just think it's zero, so I can't say anything more, but I hope I have shared something.
Thank you, Christine. Thank you, Christine. And I know how frustrating it is to have these really short periods of time, but we hope to have at least a little time for question and answer. Our next panelist is Michael Brubaker, the Alaska Native Tribal Health Consortium, the founder and director of Climate Change and Health at ANTHC, and of the local observing network, the LEO, which I hope you will also tell us about, which is about empowering local people to add information as well to what we know about our fabulous state. Michael Brubaker, please help me welcome him.
Got it. Thank you, Fran, and thank you for this opportunity to share a little bit about climate change, local monitoring, local observing, through the perspective of the tribal health system in Alaska. And it's a little bit about this cooperation, innovation, engagement, and resilience. That's a little bit about a tool that we've developed, another network that hopefully will help achieve some of that. So the Alaska Tribal Health Consortium is the largest tribally governed health organization in the United States. ANTHC co-manages the Alaska Native Medical Center and also provides engineering, environmental health, and community health services across Alaska. Our vision is that Alaska Native people are the healthiest people in the world. And despite significant challenges for health for Alaska Natives in rural Alaska communities, we know that our vision is attainable. But one of the major pillars for achieving our vision is the environment in Alaska, having a clean and healthy environment. We look at climate change impacts, both positive and negative, through the lens of public health, considering disease and injury, food and water security, and very importantly, behavioral health as well. So we need to have a clean environment to achieve our vision. But with the onset of rapid environmental change, our environment has become much less predictable, and it's affecting access to clean air, to healthy foods, and also access to clean water. So with climate change, achieving our vision has become more challenging. So in 2009, with the intent of understanding the connections between climate change, environmental health, and health effects, ANTHC founded the Center for Climate and Health. So how do we do this? How do we connect climate change, environmental impacts, and health effects? Well, one approach is by finding ways to listen to the needs of communities, to observe, to monitor, to share, and then to take action. The collection of data on wildlife, air, water, and other media has never been more important. And ANTHC has been an advocate for community-based monitoring and an approach that develops partnerships between local knowledge experts and scientists. But in addition to scientific monitoring, the collection of observation-based information is also important for understanding the types and geographic extent of impacts, for connecting communities with resources, and to coordinate planning and response efforts. To increase capacity for community-based monitoring and community-based observing, ANTHC formed the Local Environmental Observer Network in 2011. Primary funding for the LEO network has been provided by the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. LEO network members post observations about events that are unique or unusual. The observations are grounded in local and traditional knowledge. Currently, there are over 100 communities that have LEO members. Hundreds of observations on a wide range of topics have been posted to the network. The observations are transferred to web-based maps along with images, videos, audio, and links to reference materials. Selected observations are forwarded to other organizations for technical consults. In Alaska, the hub for LEO is located at ANTHC. The development of supporting hubs, this model could be applied anywhere, expanding local observation networks nationally or globally. So, an example. On October 13, 2014, Virginia Comack, the environmental manager with the Ambler Traditional Council, posted an observation about an unprecedented event. Tens of thousands of chum salmon dying before they could spawn. Comack wrote, "We've been concerned about brown foam in the bottom of the river, which is not usually there. Some people were even afraid to walk into the water." A LEO consult was provided by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and the Alaska Department of Fish and Game. The Fish and Game Pathology Lab found an unusual amount of algae on the gills and skin, suggesting that low dissolved oxygen in the water may have caused the die-off, wrote Suzanne Georgette with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. "It's likely that the stretch of hot, clear weather has contributed to this event." We are excited to expand the use of local observers and create a broader LEO network. Working with Resource Data Inc., we've developed a new handheld app which anyone can download and use, with enhanced features for field observations and data analysis. Using LEO app, local observers help provide surveillance locally and regionally for harmful algal blooms, unusual mortality events, and other types of events with special significance for northern communities. Just in the past month, a series of seabird mortality events have been reported by the LEO network. Providing evidence of a broader event, potentially, affecting birds throughout the region. The Arctic is changing fast. Being a local observer is a way to contribute to our understanding about climate change. Elders are challenged to pass on their knowledge while landscapes and seascapes remain intact. And this generation of youth can apply both their traditional knowledge and their knowledge of technology to help navigate the challenges of the future. LEO combines technology, local and traditional knowledge, and Western science to provide an effective tool for communication about climate change. In a time of increasing environmental impacts and decreasing financial resources, effective community-based strategies are important for community health. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, for not only your presentation, but your leadership in having this vision and being able to connect many generations to be part of the solution. And speaking of many generations, Jimmy, can I call you an elder, or is that inappropriate? We're going to hear from Jimmy Stotts. He is president of and chair of the Inuit Circumpolar Council. He is from Barrow. He has been a permanent participant involved in the Arctic Council for many years. I don't even know how many years. But his expertise, both from the standpoint of knowing the Arctic, but also knowing the Arctic Council process, has been fabulous on many levels. And I think we will all benefit from listening to Jimmy. Please help me welcome him.
For the sake of time, I won't get up in my advancing years. it is nice to go to the movie for half price, though. When I was young, growing up in Barrow, the U.S. Naval Arctic Research Laboratory was located about 3 miles north of the village. The town and the lab enjoyed a mutually beneficial relationship. Both sides respected each other, and they accomplished some great science together. Many of the young scientists conducting research during those days went on to have distinguished polar careers both in the Arctic and the Antarctic. Some of the men from Barrow that helped these same scientists received honorary doctorate degrees from universities. Lifelong friendships were forged. It was the proverbial win-win situation. So what happened? Why did indigenous knowledge and science stop working together? Where did the mutual respect go? Why is it different today? Sadly, we don't have the time right now to discuss this. But I'm here to tell you the relationship between indigenous communities and science used to be better. We need to get back to that time if we expect to have a strong observing network. We need to get back to that time to create better work products. I'm going to give you some insight on community-based monitoring from an Inuit perspective. What I'm about to say is not new to Inuit, but might be new to some of you in the audience. First, our definition of community-based monitoring. A process of routine observing of environmental and/or social phenomena that is led and undertaken by community members. I'll repeat that. Led and undertaken by community members and can involve collaboration and support from government and outside researchers. Community-based monitoring is distinct from citizen science, which is when the public is involved in data collection to address researcher data needs. I'll be done away before you're done. Some advantages of using community-based monitoring include, when done right, it automatically utilizes indigenous knowledge and provides the opportunity for the co-production of knowledge, which is indigenous knowledge and science together. Enhancing understanding of the ecosystem, changes in long-term trends, etc. It increases the capacity for resource management and decision-making at the local and regional level. It increases community adaptation and resilience. It is more cost and time effective compared to monitoring from the outside. This is a very important consideration in today's times. Some good practices of community-based monitoring include to build capacity in communities, contribute to indigenous institution building, developing communication structures and technologies, to support knowledge transfer, in the co-production of different ways of knowing, to support the building of networks or feeding into larger networks, to use the information to inform decision making and natural resource management, and the development of data management tools and policies. Some difficulties of using community-based monitoring include, there is a lack of universal data management, which includes questions about data ownership. Long-term funding is very difficult to find and secure. Overarching frameworks would be helpful to support research ethics, data and method standardization, and to ensure the use of community-based monitoring data in policy development and decision-making, especially at higher government or international levels. In many cases, scientists still have not understood the value of community-based monitoring or indigenous knowledge, and there are misconceptions and ignorance with regards to it. This brings me to a comment about indigenous knowledge. We don't generally support the term traditional knowledge. The term traditional knowledge sounds like something that's static, not able to evolve over time, something not relevant in a modern context. To us, the term traditional knowledge is misleading and weak. What we are talking about here is culture. The term traditional knowledge does not acknowledge the culture behind the knowledge. This may have something to do with the misconceptions and ignorance between Inuit communities and science that I mentioned earlier. This is a little food for thought. Thank you.
Thank you, Jimmy. That was excellent. And I would just encourage you to think about teaching some short courses on the topic of indigenous knowledge at some of our universities, because even a short course, I think, would be very helpful, as I know many scientists who would really like to be better at this. And speaking of really excellent scientists, we have one with us today, Hajo Eicken from the University of Alaska Fairbanks. I think he is the acting director of IARC, and he is well respected as a polar oceans ice expert. So Hajo, please help me welcome Hajo.
Thank you, Fran. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I just wanted to highlight a few of the things that were already brought up by the speakers before me on the panel, using more specific illustrations of some of the points that were made, in particular with respect to, and this actually is a nice view of the sea ice out in Barrow a couple of years ago in the early spring, using illustrations of sea ice, which I still feel is one of the great places of instruction. I'm certainly still an undergraduate at CS College following Reggie Jewell's comments this morning. So here's a view of observations in the U.S. Arctic, in U.S. Arctic waters. This is for a specific year, 2011-12. What we did was just try to get an idea of what is it actually that we're talking about if we're talking about observations and part of them sustained observations. So for this year, we looked at who is actually compiling or making some of these observations. And it's instructive, I think, to reflect on this because it relates to some of the points that were made here earlier. So about a third of these observations are made by universities, academia, about one-fifth each by the federal government, by the state government, by industry and the private sector, and foreign organizations. And foreign organizations, I would like to institutes, in particular, efforts by Japan, South Korea, China, this number may even be higher in part because of reporting challenges. And then we also have those somewhat smaller, if you look at the number of projects or number of observations, very important local government tribal organizations and the state government. So you look at this and some people who are coming at this from the perspective of let's design a well-defined, scientifically structured and justified observing system might look at this and say, well, this is just a patchwork of stuff that's being done, right? What I'd like to sort of throw out to you to consider is that this is the way Arctic observing happens. There's nothing we can do about it, and maybe it's a good thing because it's a collaborative effort. A lot of it is bottom-up. You have an important role played by university organizations, academia, but also, as Jimmy Stotts mentioned, a lot of the sustained observations are made in villages and communities informally, but in many ways contribute greatly to the overall availability of information. Why is that important? Number of issues. This morning, some of you might have been in the emergency preparedness response session. I would pose that as you respond to emergencies in this area, as everybody's well aware, a lot of the first responders will be based out of villages. They will rely on information that's available through these types of observing networks. So you're going to have to find ways in which this type of information can be leveraged and built on in the case of rapid response. The DHS Center of Excellence here in Anchorage that is actually helping with that is going to be an important part of this type of effort, but so will be other nations. You know, this morning, the example that was brought by Admiral Abel was, you know, rescue of somebody on a Korean research vessel. That Korean research vessel was putting buoys in U.S. waters that are improving our weather forecasts, as well as weather forecasts and forecasts of extreme events in Eastern Asia. And it's that type of collaboration and linkage that we want to build on the Arctic, because we're good at it, and we're good at it even at times where there may be larger scale global consideration that may make collaboration outside of the Arctic more difficult. So you can think of this sort of, you know, as an academic, of course, we like to make diagrams that are near unintelligible. This is a good example. But it illustrates the challenge that Dr. Sullivan already alluded to as well, is that if you want to produce actionable data, information that can inform decisions, you oftentimes think about this from the perspective of a desired outcome by a stakeholder. And if I talk to my research colleagues, if I'm telling them, hey, we have to make sure that the data that we're collecting within academia are dual purpose, that they both help us understand the Arctic system better, but that they also serve desirable outcomes from the stakeholder perspective. As soon as you say desirable to a geophysicist or a physical oceanographer, it's like, whoa, you know, don't talk to me about desires in the context of my research. But it is this question of how do you link these two different worlds of observing that is part of the challenge. And it may be just as important, and I think we've heard that implicitly from some of the panel members here, maybe just as important to put resources into improving the information flow and the communication across these different perspectives on the Arctic environment. One way to do that is, and I think actually Jimmy Stotts described a great example, communities of practice, informal collaborations where, such as in Barrow, where I've learned a lot about the sea ice from people like Kenneth Tuvok, who worked early on with NARL. These types of informal collaborations that build themselves from the ground up, those are ways to deal with both the opportunities we have for collaboration, but also the fact that the increased activity and the rapid Arctic change demand collaboration. And the challenge is that building good communities of practice is as much a question of resources as it is of kind of the social science and the informal ways of getting at this. So how do we do this? I just want to illustrate one quick example, again, using my favorite material on Earth, sea ice. One way is to think about it not so much compartmentalized, and of course, a lot of people are not news, but thinking about it, what services do we gain from the ice cover? And people often forget that even the lower 48 or outside, climate regulation by the sea ice cover is a very important factor. There's a lot of federal agencies who are studying this, but thinking about it in the context of services is an important part. Same is true for climate regulation or coastal protection, the role of sea ice in supporting subsistence activities. Again, we've heard from Mike Brubaker about this. And also in the context of hazards, where, of course, sea ice plays an important role. Are there ways to build communities of practice? Again, I would argue that one example is the sea ice prediction network, or SIPN, that's brought together different experts from different communities and different backgrounds. I encourage you to look at the Arctic Sea Ice Outlook as one product of that group. But this also includes collaboration such as flight lines from NASA flights, industry, and National Science Foundation supported research that is being evaluated here from the perspective of data quality. Again, something that Dr. Sullivan was getting at. But it also involves people like Jill Levitt up in Barrow, who's shared observations and made regular observations as part of a sea ice observing network, trying to find ways in which you can link all of these things together in a single context. That's a big challenge, and I would argue that we need to be sure that we have both resources, but also the time and the help in bridging some of these communication gaps that we may encounter. Again, co-production of knowledge. Jimmy Stotts already alluded at that. Co-management of data is a very important aspect of this. And what you see here, these co-management approaches, those are some of the low-hanging fruit that I would argue we need to focus on in observing networks. Thank you.
Thank you, Hajo. I wish we had another hour to dig deeper into all of this, but we don't. I think we have time for two quick questions before we adjourn upstairs. So if the microphone, there we go, in the back, right there. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Great stuff. I'm Jim Gamble with Allied International Association. We're also involved in some fairly extensive community-based monitoring efforts, and we're also involved with SAON. And so one of the things that we struggle with is trying to bridge those two things. So in other words, this is data we're developing on the ground. How do we make it interoperable at the SAON level, this overarching Arctic observing network? And that there's a lot of factors there. I realize it's a broad question, but metadata, interoperability, how does, I'm just curious how the panel sees bridging this huge overarching network like SAON with information developed on the ground by communities themselves.
One person can answer it. Who wants to? Hajo, go for it.
It's a great question, a big challenge. You have to take it step by step. One way is part of the SAON sponsored activity jointly with International Arctic Science Committee is the so-called Arctic Science Summit Week and the Arctic Observing Summit. Next year in March, March 12th through 18, it'll be in Fairbanks. And in fact, but you know, good opportunity to plug, but there's two groups, or actually three groups, that are part of the Observing Summit that are trying to get at this at a tractable level. One, co-chaired by the World Ocean Council and a consortium from Canada compiling remote sensing data, looking at developing protocols and interoperability standards for platforms of opportunity by industry. So this involves oil and gas industry, shipping industry, and others. The great thing about that summit is that at the same time, there's a group co-led by Rochelle Daniel here from Alaska, Lena Kielsen-Holm from Greenland, and Robert Way from Canada, from Nunavik, who's looking at this question of traditional knowledge, indigenous knowledge, community-based observing. And that summit, because it is a summit where you bring together people who already chew through the problems through white papers and other things in advance, is going to be a great opportunity to at least see where can we make progress in the international context. And this includes other countries outside of the Arctic as well.
One more question. Mead Treadwell, former Lieutenant Governor, former Chair of the U.S. Arctic Research Commission.
Thank you. Madam Chair, I'm just wondering if you can speak a little bit, and maybe the panelists, to the value of the science agreement, which is being discussed under the U.S. chairmanship, and how might that tie in with community-based monitoring?
Very briefly, the Arctic Council, as many of you know, has in the past only really helped negotiate among the eight Arctic nations two agreements, one on search and rescue and one on oil spill response. But for the last year and a half, there have been discussions about a third agreement that might be on international cooperation of Arctic science. And a lot of progress has been made, and it is actually the hope that such an agreement would be signed during the U.S. chairmanship. I don't know that that will happen, but I'm reasonably optimistic that it will. The principal goal of an agreement like that, I think, is to raise up the importance of working together to make certain that the science that is done by each of the individual nations, not to mention all of the nations of the world that contribute to Arctic science knowledge, work together in an open and transparent way, in a way that shares data, and in a way that really advances our common need for understanding of the change that is happening in the Arctic and the implications for humans. Exactly how that will work in terms of how it integrates with local observing or indigenous knowledge, I don't have the answer to that question, Mead. I think there is a good faith effort to not only encourage that from the Arctic Council itself in a number of the working groups, that has become a priority ingredient in how it evaluates what work the working groups will do to incorporate Indigenous knowledge, but through this agreement as well. So I would just have to say, time will tell how that really works out, but stay tuned. Ladies and gentlemen, the reason I'm going to call time on this session is because I know everyone wants to get a good seat upstairs. But I do want to say in closing, first of all, I want to thank our excellent panelists who have provided a lot of understanding about the complexity of this issue. And I want to thank all of the people in the audience today, business, private sector, public sector, academia, federal agencies, state agencies, who in many ways labor sometimes without adequate resources to help us advance the state of knowledge of what is happening in the Arctic. Let's keep going. It's a very important common mission. And hopefully as time goes by, we will do a better job of, as Hajo just said, communicating effectively to make this information much more available to the public and to the people who need it. Thank you very much.